Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is September 27th, 2015. This is our 10:30 service.
Thank you. the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
The second reading is from James. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up. And anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Pastor's going up the raised pulpit to deliver the gospel.
Most times I come up here them, they had $25,000. Well, today, I'm here to ask you for $3,200. I already have a down payment of $800, a fourth of the cost of the fixing of the doors. Our outside doors don't open anymore. The big ones out on the big street, the little ones out beside the elevator, and they look like the Dickens in it. And no church should have doors that aren't open on Sunday morning. So we need to have those doors fixed. We have a man who will do it for $3,200. He's a good contractor. If you've been to the Buckeye Club, you can see the things that he did over there. He's a decent contractor. And he has given us a bid of $3,200 to do all the wooden doors that we have. I didn't even know there was a wooden door down here on this part of the building, but he'd have to do that too to make it look good. The double doors, they're all going to have to be reframed and everything. So, this I thought was a good deal, and we really need to have something like that, because I really dislike bringing someone down to my church and showing them, and then they say, well, where does this go? And I say, it goes nowhere because it won't open. That isn't right. The church doors all should be open and crowd that take people in every Sunday morning. So write your checks to St. John's Lutheran Door Fund for whatever amount you want, and send it to the church. We're going to set up a thing tomorrow morning. I'm going to go in and put the $800 in that I've already collected. So we'll start that fund, and we'll see if we can't get it paid for before the man gets done working. If he doesn't, then I guess I'll have to stand it, but I'll do it. Thank you very much.
Have entertainment by the praise band today.
Thank you. Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. A woman was driving down the street in town. She had a fellow in front of him, and they were approaching an intersection. And as the fellow in front of her reached the intersection, the light began to go from green to yellow. The gentleman in front of her immediately stopped, and she had to slam on her brakes to keep from rear-ending because she had expected him to go through so she could go through. So after slamming on her brakes, she rolled down her window and began shaking her fist at the man and yelling at him and cussing at him and blowing her horn and carrying on until the light went through its cycle and changed, and he went through the light and she went through. And as she was driving down, she looked up at her rearview mirror, and there were a police car behind her with his lights flashing. And in the rearview mirror, she could see the officer pointing her to pull over. So she pulls over, the police officer walked up to her, pulled out his gun, held it up to her and said, "Lady, get out of the car with your hands up." So the lady, having no idea what was going on, got out of the car with her hands up. He told her to put her hands on the car, he frisked her, told her to put her hands behind her back, he cuffed her, took her down to the police station and put her in a holding cell in order to book her. Well, after about 20 minutes, in came her husband with the police officer. And the police officer apologized profusely for having pulled her over and arrested her. And she asked him, he said, "Well, why did you arrest me?" And he said, "Well, when I saw what happened at the light, when the fellow didn't go through and you slammed on your brakes and you started cussing at him and yelling and screaming and shaking your fist, and I read the back of your car and it said, 'Jesus first, Jesus is Lord, what would Jesus do?' You had the old fish symbol for the Christian faith. I figured you hadn't stolen that car, because if you believe it was that one, we knocked that one." Well, that little story brings home the point of Jesus today in our gospel lesson. Jesus, as he brings this ninth chapter to a close, is talking to those of us who believe in him, those of us who would be his followers, of what is of vital importance when one considers himself to be a child of God, a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. And what Jesus is telling us basically is that the old excuse, "Everybody is doing it," does not cut it with him. Because as a follower of Jesus Christ, you have been called to a higher standard. You have been called to a way of life in order to be an example to the rest of society, so that by your example, you can prevent the moral decay of society. Jesus is telling us that to believe in him and to follow him is much more than words. That it is a way of living. And he begins with some strange words that oftentimes have been misunderstood. After John has complained that someone was not one of them, was casting out demons in his name, he tells them, "Don't worry about that. If they're for us, they're not against us. He's doing our work." Then he talks about cutting off your arm, your hand, your feet, gouging out your eyes. You have to realize that Jesus always is speaking about the spiritual, not the physical. He's not concerned about the physical, but the spiritual. He's speaking spiritually. He's not literally saying, "Cut off your hand, cut off your foot, and gouge out your eye in order to enter the kingdom of heaven." That would be works of righteousness. But he's talking about, again, he's talking about the character of a Christian being at a higher standard than those who are not Christians in the society. And unfortunately, though, you have people who will read a passage like this and with no understanding go out and do it. I can remember when I was serving Hopeful Lutheran in Florence, Kentucky. And a story was in the paper one day about some fellow down in some rural county below Florence and picked up his King James Version of the Bible and said he'd seen the light and he was God calling me a preacher, and he started a little church, and he literally had someone in the congregation cut off their hand. illustratively, not purposely, that it was a figure of speech, of an illustration. So we are called to that higher standard. And as I was working on the message, instead of our sermon text being verses 43 to 48, as it has in your bulletin, I was led instead to focus on this verse 50. So if you return with me to that ninth chapter of the Gospel of Mark, the 50th verse, another verse that sounds somewhat strange when we read it, we will understand why it was important for that woman at that intersection not to behave like as she did, but to instead have accepted the fellow stopping it and not made any comment about it. As Jesus says in verse 50, salt is good, but if the salt has lost saltiness, how will you make it salty again? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. Now all of us use salt. We use it to add flavor to meat. We use it to change the flavor of something when we are cooking. In the ancient world, salt was very bad. Salt was used not just to preserve meat and fish. It was used to not only to penetrate cooking, which you were cooking, it was also used to help and heal. Newborn babies were rubbed down in salt as a way of trying to prevent them from catching any kind of disease. It is argued back and forth among scholars, but the evidence seems to be there, that the Roman legions, part of their pay was salt. Not just coinage, not just beer, but also salt, because salt had a specific value and it could be used as currency. And so when Jesus is speaking, everybody knows about the value of salt. Now, in our homes, we put salt in a salt shaker and it stays there for months and months and months and never goes bad. The only time I have ever heard of salt losing its saltiness is a story about that comes to us from the ancient world, where some king tried to hoard a bunch of salt, so he stored it in a bunch of shacks like that had earthen floors, and that the salt that was right on the dirt and just above it, that salt had lost the saltiness and they had to throw it out the street, but all the rest of the salt was still good. But remember, when Jesus is telling a parable, it's not always that every fact needs to be understood. It's for the purpose of making a point. So let's look again at what Jesus is saying. Salt is good. What did Jesus mean by this? Well, on the surface, people would say, yeah, salt is good. It preserves, it penetrates, it heals. But that's not what many scholars say Jesus is saying. They're saying salt represents the Word of God. So Jesus is saying the Word of God is good, and that the word good literally stands for the gospel. So the Word of God is the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is the basis of the church. As we say in our confessions, all faith and belief is based on the Word of God. So the Word of God is the gospel of good news of Jesus Christ. But if it has lost its saltiness, that means if it has become worldly, how do you make it salty again? So we'll stop right there. The salt has lost its saltiness to become worldly. Today, unfortunately, people have taken the Word of God and twisted it to fit their agenda. Taking words of our Lord Jesus Christ that are as clear as can be and twisted it in order to support a political or social agenda that they want to push forward. Instead of looking at what the Word is really saying and allowing the Word to interpret itself, they give it a new interpretation to back themselves up. That is making the Word worldly. And when we make it worldly, it loses its effect. When we try to tell God what He means, instead of God telling us what we mean, then we run into problems. It has always been the standard of our church, meaning the Lutheran throughout history, is that the word trumps reason. In other words, if Jesus says something and it's hard for us to understand, we go by what Jesus said. Like when Jesus instituted the sacrament of the altar, the Lord's Supper, Holy Communion, he said, "This is my body. This is my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." Now reason says, how can you eat the body and blood of Jesus Christ? Reason says, how can the body and blood of Jesus Christ be in every church and every time when there is communion? Well, we say reason doesn't understand it because it's stained by sin. Jesus said it. Therefore, when we gather at the Lord's table, we believe that we are receiving his body and blood for the forgiveness of sin and for our salvation, as he taught, as he commanded us. And so we allow the word to trump reason. Now, some groups allow reason to trump the word, and when you do that, there's a danger of the word becoming world. So the word is good. The gospel of Jesus Christ is good. We cannot allow it to become worldly. We cannot interpret it through the world. We cannot interpret it through political agendas. We cannot interpret it through social agendas. We interpret it through Jesus Christ. And so with the word, then we become the preserver of morality in society. We become the flavor of society. We give the flavor to society. So we don't do what everybody else does. We are to live at this higher standard. See, people often make the mistake of thinking that when God gave the Ten Commandments to Moses, that he had a low opinion of humanity. But the reality is, God gave the Ten Commandments to Moses because he had a high regard for humanity. He was saying, if I believe it in me, you can fulfill these commands that I give. That you can make me the one and only God. You cannot use my name in vain. You can't remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. You cannot honor your father and mother. You cannot kill. You cannot commit adultery. You cannot steal. You cannot bear false witness. You cannot covet. But it takes faith. And Jesus comes along. And Jesus reemphasizes that we have been called by God into this new Israel, into this new covenant, and that we have been made the light in the darkened room. We are to be that city shining on a hill that cannot be hid. We are to be the yeast that makes the whole dough rise. We are to be that salt that flavors society correctly, not incorrectly. And so as brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, we have that responsibility proclaim the good news to society to prevent its moral decay. When St. Paul refers so often to the church in his letters as holy, he does not mean that we are better than anybody else. He does not mean that we are superior. The word holy means to be set apart to God for a special purpose. We have been set apart by God through our baptism, through our faith, for that special purpose of enlightening the rest of the world of the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. When St. Peter calls us a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, again, he is not saying we go around sticking our chest out, thumping them, and saying, I'm so much better than you because I believe in Jesus. No, he's saying we have been called to this mission. And part of that mission is to bring more people into the kingdom, not keep them out, to bring them in, to bring more and more in, to let people realize that no matter how far they wandered off from God, that God always welcomes them back with loving arms. That was the whole point of the parable of what we know as a prodigal son, but which more and more scholars say should really be called the prodigal of the loving father. Because the father, of course, represents God. The son represents we sinners. The son repents, returns to his father, willing to be nothing more than a slave. His father welcomes him with open arms and holds a feast because his son was dead and now he's alive. So it is vital, of vital importance that we recognize that we preserve, we are to heal the goodness of society and call others to that higher standard of living. Today, everybody wants to drum everything down. Drum everything down so that everybody's the same and everybody can wallow around in the gutter together. But God knows we can be better than that. God knows with the help of the Holy Spirit, we can live this higher standard of living. We can live those values of the Sermon on the Mount that Jesus gave us in chapters 5 through 7 of the Gospel of Matthew. That we can fulfill those words he said in the Gospel of John in the upper room. That we love one another as he loved us. And so it is of vital importance that we recognize our responsibility to our Lord Jesus Christ. In the Old Testament, the Hebrew children are called to be a light unto the nations. God chose them not for them to stick their chest out and thump their chest and say, we're the chosen ones of God. No, you Gentiles are going to hell. He chose them to enlighten the Gentiles as to what God was really like, who the real God really was, what God was all about. But as the years went by, they forgot their commission. And they began to look at it that meant being the chosen people, meant they were the only ones God cared about. And it didn't matter that the Romans occupied them, because one day the Romans would get it right in the neck, and they would be elevated above all people. And so God makes the new covenant, sends his son Jesus Christ into the world to suffer and die on the cross to pay the debt of sin that we owe, so that we might be his own and live under him in his kingdom. But at the same time, fulfill that great commission of going to every village, every hamlet, every town, every nation, every island, every atoll, every continent, every whatever, spreading the good news of the gospel and bringing people into the kingdom. So the word of God is the gospel, and it loses its effectiveness when you allow it to become worldly. But have salt in yourselves. This means to keep the seasoning. In other words, keep the faith and be at peace with one another. So Jesus is telling us about remaining loyal to his word. And by keeping the faith in his word, we will have peace as a community of believers, and we will be able to share peace with the society in which we live as they see our example. But we're not a good example if we're at a light cussing and screaming and shaking our fist at the driver in front of us, because they didn't know through a yellow light. It's the same thing when we're in a store and the cashier is taking a long time with the person in front of us. What kind of example are we to the world if we yell and berate that cashier for taking so long? A couple of weeks ago, I went down here to Lee's Fried Chicken to order some supper for Gina and myself. When I walked in, I knew I was in trouble as soon as I walked in, because all these people were there standing around sitting in the chicken and none of them had food. So I made my order and the woman told me, she warned me, it was going to take a while. And I mean, I'm not stupid. See all these people in front of you, know it's going to take a while. Well, as I was sitting there waiting on my food, the girl came out of the back to give this table next to me where I was sitting their food. And as she put it down, the woman, and I don't know if this family was Christian or not, I have no idea if they were any belief whatsoever, but the woman replied very nastily and hatefully and said, well, nice that we're going to be able to eat sometime this year. See, we are called to be above that. Yes, it's frustrating, but it's not what's important when you compare it to eternity. It's not important when you look at Jesus Christ hanging on that cross with that crown of thorns and the blood gushing out of the wounds from the spikes that had been driven into him. And you see him suffering, carrying the debt of sin, the penalty of sin that we owe. willingly giving himself up for our sake. Being nasty to that server just didn't work. And so Jesus is saying, you now are the salt of society. You are what is to give it this flavor. And if you don't do it, then there's moral decay. Then society crumbles. And we have seen that happen over and over again in civilizations that allowed the word to become diluted, when they allowed the word to become worldly instead of spiritual. We've seen those communities fall. We have seen the tragedy that comes with it. We don't have to go back any further than World War II. As Hitler tried to Nazify the church. And unfortunately, there were those priests and those Lutheran pastors that went along with it. But then there were others like Bonhoeffer and Niebuhr, others who refused to go along with it and were sent to concentration camps. Some would survive, and some like Bonhoeffer would be executed just days before the camp being liberated by the U.S. Army. But they were a light in that darkness of Nazism. They were a light showing society, and that light had an effect on people. It may have been a minority, it may have been a majority that was too scared to speak. But at least they spoke. They kept the light shining. They remained that city on the hill which could not be hid. And so Jesus is telling us the word, the gospel is the good news. We take that word into society and flavor society with it so that we live as God intended us to live. So that we live in relationship with Him and relationship with God, with each other as God intended when He put our first parents in the Garden of Eden. That we show the world that God really loves us. And again, no matter how far we wander from Him, He is always ready. So we must do more than have bumper stickers on our car. We must do more than simply say, I believe in Jesus. We must also show it by our actions. We must be that flavor to a decaying society. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Please turn to page 105 in the front of your worship book. And again, I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father, Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
The praise band will perform during the offertory.
Strength like no other.
God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their need. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Help us care for one another and lead those who have turned away from you to return to your ways. Gather those who have not sought you to come to your table and fill them with your Spirit, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Teach us, Lord, not to ignore the needs of others, but to hold them up. Instead of turning our backs to them, lead us to help them obtain what they need in this earthly life. As Moses cared for your people, let us care for others. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, we ask that you help us open our churches, not only for our members, but also for our community. Where there is a need, let us fill it. May we open our doors not only on Sunday, but each day you have given us to praise you, teach, and reach out to all. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Where there is grumbling, may it cease. Let us work together for your good and not for our own. Help us stand as one in your service. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Be with those who cannot be with us today. Heal their minds and bodies. If in your love you call them home, comfort us in the knowledge they are rejoicing with you in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Be with those who live alone. Remind us of the opportunity and responsibility to check in on them so they do not feel lonely or abandoned. Show us what they need before they must ask for help. Help us include them in our festivities and our daily lives. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Into your hands we commend all those whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep you, now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with Here I Am, Lord, hymn number 574, in the back of your worship, hymn number 574.
Thank you.
thank you for being with us at our 10:30 service this morning. St. John's Lutheran Church is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. You can contact us at 937-323-7508. Our church is handicap accessible. We have an 8 o'clock and 10:30 service, Sunday school at 9:15, adult and children's classes. We have the food pantry every Wednesday, the outreach store Monday through Friday, closed on Thursday. Rainbow table on Fridays, noon to 1. Everyone is welcome to share a meal.